Very wet, captains. Ah!
Hi everybody, it's Valentine's Day and it's 25 past 6 in the evening, so I'm losing the light a little bit. I've been doing a bit of video editing and Svetlana's taken the dogs for a walk, so you might hear some barking in the background as they come back. I've got Begemot here asleep. Yes, okay, he's recovering from his car accident. So he's still got a purple thing sticking out of his leg, but he's getting better. So I thought I'd do a quick video on Shenzhen and buying a boat in Europe. Main reason for that is that quite a few people have asked for it. One of our subscribers, Lee, was planning on buying a boat in Gibraltar and living on board there. So I thought I'd do a little piece on Shenzhen. It's been done before. Other YouTubers have done this. So there's a great video from Intrepid Bear, which I'll put a link to, that details this in more depth. But basically, if you come to the EU and you wanted to spend a lot of time here, there are some things you need to be aware of. And one of them is this thing called Shenzhen. Okay, now Shenzhen started in 1985. It was a treaty that was signed by a number of EU countries that basically meant that they didn't have to have borders between the countries. So as a citizen of Shenzhen, you could live and work anywhere in the Shenzhen area without need for work visas or anything like that. You're a Shenzhen citizen, you can work there. It also meant that you can buy goods and services from there and you don't have to worry about import tax. And things like that. It's all sort of standardized. Over the years, more and more countries have joined. Most of the European Union is now in the Shenzhen area, as well as one or two countries that are not, and more countries are joining. So what does that mean to us non-Shenzhen citizens? Well, you can visit the Shenzhen area for 90 days. It's 90 days out of any rolling 180 days. So what does that actually mean? Essentially, if I enter the Shenzhen area in January, stay for 30 days and then leave, and then come back in April and stay April and May. So let's say I come back on the 2nd of April because there's 31 days in May. So that's 60 days in a block. Then I've stayed my 90 days, but 1st of June, the 1st of January drops off. So basically I can roll into June. I can stay for June because it takes up my 90 days. Once my 90 days is up, however, I've got to leave. I've got to leave the Shenzhen area. Okay, and basically I can't come back until I've got some days free in my rolling 90 days out of 180, which is fine, but as the Shenzhen area has grown so much, when you are living and cruising on a sailboat, that's not quite so easy. And that's developed this thing called the Shenzhen shuffle, where you stay in the Shenzhen area for a period of time and then you move to a non-Shenzhen country. But the number of non-Shenzhen countries that are within easy reaching distance is shrinking. That's because more and more countries are joining. So for example, Gibraltar was a popular spot for doing the Shenzhen shuffle, as is Turkey, Montenegro, Albania, and so on. But Gibraltar, for example, joins the Shenzhen area this year, 2023, as does Bulgaria, Romania, and I think Albania. So the number of countries that you can visit is rapidly diminishing. So what are the alternatives to Shenzhen? If we want to stay longer, if you're a citizen of the rest of the world, then there is something called a long-term visa. Long-term visas are a 12-month visa and can be extended up to 2 years. That's if you want to sort of tour around Europe. So you can apply for that. You have to apply for it at the embassy before you leave. You need to plan for that. You could come on a student visa if you're being sponsored by a university, for example. You could come on a work visa. This is where you come to work for a company in that country, and that company sponsors you. Alternatives, there is something called a golden pass, where if you have 250,000 euros of equity assets as such, and you're planning to buy property in the country, then you can come on a golden pass. And finally, there is now something called a digital nomad. So more and more people like me are working remotely. So I still have a full-time job. I work 100% remote. So I could actually apply for a digital nomad visa if I didn't have the residency. And again, that's a 12-month visa extendable up to 2 years. And that's where you're working for a company that is not part of Shenzhen. The company is effectively your income. So those are the options when we're talking about sort of living long term in Europe, specifically the Shenzhen area. So having talked about living in the Shenzhen area, let's talk about buying a boat. So if you look on the internet and you look at boats in Europe, you'll see them advertised as EU VAT paid or VAT unpaid. So if it's a VAT paid boat, that means that the duty has been paid within the EU. And if you buy the boat, the duty comes with it, so it's duty paid within the EU. If you take it outside of the EU, then as the owner, you have the right to re-import at any time up to 3 years without paying any duty. After 3 years, you may be eligible to pay the VAT again, depending on what country you re-enter the EU. If it's a VAT unpaid boat, a tax unpaid boat, usually something like maybe it's coming from a charter company, then they haven't paid the VAT. So as a private individual, you will be liable to pay the duty at the point of purchasing the boat. And that will be whatever the tax office determined the value of the boat to be, not necessarily the purchase price. So you need to bear that in mind if you're buying an EU VAT unpaid boat. Obviously, there are potential ways around it. If you set up a company, for example, and that company is VAT registered, then you can buy the boat through a company. But that's a lot more complicated because then you're into accounts and company returns and all that sort of malarkey. Boats of a certain age are deemed EU VAT paid, and the age of the boat will also vary depending on which country you are buying it from and when they joined the EU. So there are certain countries where it's slightly newer than others. But generally speaking, 1992, anything below 1992 is VAT paid. British registered boats gets more complicated. So If you have a British registered boat that was in the EU at the time of Brexit, then it is deemed VAT paid. But the clock is ticking because you have 3 years to be able to re-import it into the UK. Otherwise, you may end up liable for UK VAT. The problem with buying a British registered boat is that the right to re-import is for the owner. So the person that owns the boat on export is the person that has to re-import it. So that could get a bit complicated. And the same goes the other way around. So if you're buying a boat in the UK that is UK registered, then it won't be EU VAT paid. So if you bring it into the EU, you have 18 months of usage in the EU before you've got to leave. And then you can leave for 24 hours and then come back. So this right to import, so right to export and right to re-import. But again, there is a 3 year rule to get it back to the UK. So we just need to bear that in mind. So buying a boat in Europe, yeah, eminently possible. They're a lot cheaper, I've heard, than they are in the US. So it's definitely the way forward. But you need to be careful when you register the boat, which flag you put it under and what have you. Our boat here, Captain Svetlana, we bought her from a German couple. It was EU VAT paid and it was a German registered boat. Rather than register it in the UK with all the hassle of VAT and everything else, we chose to register it in Sweden. And that means that it's still an EU VAT paid boat, effectively. Other flags of convenience are potentially Poland. We chose Sweden because it was easy for us. So just bear it in mind. Okay, that's it for another video. I hope you enjoyed and find it informative. I am by no means a lawyer, and this is by no means an exhaustive explanation of Shenzhen or buying a boat in the EU. But I will put some links in the description down below to some of the sites that I've used for research. Yeah, please let us know how you get on. If you've got any questions, please drop them into the comments. And hope to see you soon. Thanks.